want to thank the presence of the Holy Spirit for this divine opportunity to be here. All glory, glory to the presence of the Holy Spirit. And also to our most highly, highly esteemed Papa Joshua. Mama Yemi is here. To you all too for coming for service. Let's take our seats, please. I want to take a few minutes to just share thoughts with us. And we trust that it will bless you.
Amen. Amen.
It will.
Yes.
Amen.
Turn to Songs of Solomon, chapter 8. Songs of Solomon, chapter 8. Songs of Solomon, chapter 8. Amen. Songs of Solomon, chapter 8.
Yeah.
You have Proverbs, you have Psalms, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes. Then Song of Solomon.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Amen. So are you all there?
Amen.
Yes.
Amen and amen.
Amen.
Shout fire.
Fire.
Now in verses 8 of Songs of Solomon, chapter 8. Oh, not only the chapter.
Yes, sir.
Song of Solomon, chapter 8, verses 8 says, we have a little sister, and she has no breast. What shall we do for our sister in the day when she is spoken for? And so I want to discuss the subject titled, She Has No Breast.
Yeah.
And it's a concern. Now, if you go to, if you look at the subheading before that, verses 8, you get to see that it was a brother that was having concern for his sister.
Yes, sir.
He said, look, we have a concern for our sister. He said, well, what shall we do for her? Because a time will come, and the time is near, somebody will come and request for a hand in marriage. But I doubt if the man will be interested when he finally sees her and discover she has no breast. Now, this is not even a little child. This is a grown-up, an adult. So a brother is having a concern for his sister. He said, my sister is already grown up. She's very mature. She is fine. She's good looking. People will like her. He said, but I think we should start thinking of what we can do for her. That means that since we are just the only ones who can accommodate her, I doubt if outsiders can accommodate her the way we do. I doubt. Now, this is not a man who is seeing a vision. He is actually acknowledging here a physical defect in the life of his own sister. So, what are the defects you have? that can make someone never to be interested. Because Solomon is acknowledging here that there are people who have physical defects, and that would just be their doom. Now you need to understand, this particular sister that this brother was concerned about is a very wonderful sister. And this was the reason why the brother could have this concern for his sister. You need to understand, see something here. He says, if she is a wall, who build upon her a battlement of silver, and if she is a door, who enclose her with boards of cedar. In other words, here he's talking about how this sister of theirs is always there for them, always available. If we need anything, our sister will give us. She will give us her last. She can stand to defend us. No matter what, she loves us. But I doubt if a man can really care for her, knowing that she does not have any grace. In other words, here you are looking at certain people in life. No matter how nice they are, there are certain defects in their life that can make them never see help till they die. And that's why now you need to be concerned about the way you treat you. In other words, he's telling us here that the things you can play down on and ignore now can be your doom in the future. So, as children, you find a little girl with a little boy. The little boy runs and climbs the tree. The little girl climbs the tree. So, you say, don't climb trees again. Stop climbing trees. Then she says, well, so some person is climbing trees. She's pointing to the boy now. So the father says, but you are a boy. But he's a boy. You are a girl. A girl is also, so I can do what he can do. Maybe she can even climb the trees better. And maybe the father is just trying to protect her not to have a fall that will make a man not to be interested in her. Sometimes what you are being warned from doing may not be for now. It may be for the future. Who will be interested in you later on? Okay, of all the women in the world, why should this man marry this woman with one eye? When there are many good women who have both eyes seeing. And this guy is expressing concern. See, this is my sister. She's good. See, this kind of defect can also reflect in attitude. Well, what is your attitude like? And who is a relative of yours that is concerned about your attitude? Sister, with the way you are going, I doubt if a man would like to marry you. This guy is even saying that his sister is kind. His sister is nice. His sister is wonderful. His sister is there. Oh, man. She can make sacrifices for us. But I really want her to be like the other women. I want her to have an excellent life. I want her to be joyful. But the challenge is She has no doubt. So here, he is telling us that no matter how spiritual we may be, there are physical qualities people still look out for. No matter how spiritual we may be, there are still physical qualities that someone may be looking out for. Maybe the way you smile, it can be an advantage. So there was a reason God made this one taller than this one. So your height can be an advantage. See? Not that this lady was sick. It's okay, because she didn't grow in the right environment, she could not go. So that means that even though she was always there defending her siblings were always watching her. Hey, see this auntie. Have you ever had an auntie, maybe your mother, sister, who has come to live with you guys? She took care of you people, but you know, when is auntie going to even live her own life? That's what he said here. When is this auntie going to live her own life? Oh, man. And it's a concern. So, man, this auntie is just too good. She's just too good. I wish she was even my mother. This brother here would have wished that his sister was his mother. He said, my sister is too good. And here's Solomon. He's speaking of that spiritual conversation. Now, don't forget, we're reading the Songs of Solomon. And then at the end of the day, oh, the whole thing ended on a sad note. See. Here, he began to talk about another lady began to talk in verse 10. I am a wall and my breast like tower. Then I became in his eyes as one who found peace. See that? So, we know Solomon liked women. He married many. But if King Solomon were to marry these two women, chances are even King Solomon, the writer, will pick the one with breast. Now, the other lady is saying, I can do what you can do too. I can be a rock of defense. See, she's selling herself too. Advertising her product. The other doesn't have anything to advertise. Even though she has even done more than this one. What we're trying to show you here, see how privileged you are. Look at the lady that is screaming, I want to divorce. You want to divorce? Why other ladies are looking for who even put a ring in their finger? You want to divorce. And you think you are older. You see, you don't take shit from. The day somebody was. A girl was crying because of a lady. Tears were coming out of his eye. Because he loved the lady. So I said, let me see the picture of the lady. And he brought out his phone and showed us the picture. And I looked at the lady. He said, brother, let this lady go. You understand? Is this the lady? I said, I understand the emotion. Brother, I've been there, but the truth of the matter, this one is not worth it. Yeah. If it's another lady, I could say, let's pray, let's turn our mind. Yeah. Then she will just focus only on you. Just make sure you serve God. You understand? But looking at the lady, what we're trying to show you here is that here is someone who is good, excellent, but Solomon said, now, Solomon is writing this. That means he saw the two of them, he looked at her. He still went for the one with breasts anyway. He just said, man. And the reason why did this brother begin to have this concern? Because he heard some men are coming to town and they are coming to their area to come and pick a woman to marry. And the guy said, my sister is the best woman that this man can marry. But this is the challenge. And I said, well, see me, I'm here. I can also do what your sister does too. And I will give him peace. Right? Yeah. She said it. He said, I can give him peace. Now, you're surprised that that scripture is in the Bible. Maybe you think we are not born again anymore.
No, we do.
Now he goes on to say, you see, even though he brings that picture of two women, one has breasts. There are two women, both mature. One is making more sacrifices, but has one defect. The other says she can do what the other one has done, but we've not seen her do anything yet. But she only said she can do. But look, I have breasts. Okay. The writer now went further to explain those two women as gardeners. Now see. Verse 11. Solomon had a vineyard at Baal Hanan. He leased the vineyard to keepers. Everyone was to bring for its fruits 1,000 silver coins. Was to make profit for it. And people were to give towards it. Then the next thing, the one speaking now, he says, my own vineyard is before me. You also, Solomon, may have 1,000. And those who tend it, its fruits. Who tend its fruit, 200. You who dwell in the garden, the companions, listen for your voice. Let me hear. Make haste, my beloved, and be like a gazelle or a young star on the mountain of spice. Here, he is telling us, look, Solomon is more privileged than we are. Yet, we still give our best for him. Yet, our own is lying fallow. So what he's just trying to say is that, you see, the reason why that girl doesn't have the breast she was supposed to have is that she wasted all her time into taking care of others that cannot even give her a husband. She was attending to other people's garden and ignored her own. So she ignored taking the food she was supposed to eat that would have helped her hormones produce. She did not. She rather gave it to her sibling, maybe her younger sister. And now that is the younger sister that is probably saying, I have breasts. Hey. So, and I can do what auntie did. See? So, who have you helped in your life that at the end of the day is now rubbing it on your face? We recall there was a pastor who left this ministry and was saying, I can do what brothers can. Go on. And everything you want to preach, I taught you. We invested in you. So I was talking to them, I said, God, why? Then the Lord said, focus on your own life. You don't need to teach everybody everything. I was surprised the Lord told me that. You don't need to preach everything. Just give what you give. You don't need to pour everything into people. I said, really? I was surprised the Lord told me that. He said, begin to plan your own life too. I said, really? He said, you saw what that pastor did, and that's not the first. The others have done their own too. When are you going to plan? Here you are. Oh, you are. The reason why you got a job is because of your mother. For my mother. Because of my mother. What she's going through. What she's going through. When are you going to plan your own plan? Is it because you are here in America and your folks are back home? Oh, I have to do things. Or your dad. You went to school, graduated. Your dad now is putting pressure on me. You don't even send money. This and that. After all, we sent you to school. And the dad who is saying they sent you to school. Here you are, you still have student loans to pay, which automatically means that daddy was not the one who sent you to school. But so much is on you. And by the time somebody is coming to say, okay, fine, let me take you off of these pressures you have gone through, the person comes and discovers there's a dent in you. And that dent is something he cannot just ignore. Because you can't persuade the guy, say, still marry her, she's a good woman. The guy said, man, look, there's no future with this woman. Someone said, what do you mean there's no future? So if she even becomes pregnant, she can't feed the children. So again, you need to begin to look at who you are really investing into at your own expense. Because at the end of the day, what will be left for you? What will be left for you? The guy here that Solomon is talking about is lamenting and he's saying, look, King Solomon, you have your own vineyard, I have my own. Now you are calling all the laborers to come and you work and at the expense of theirs. They ignore theirs. And each one is bringing you 1,000 pieces of silver. We don't even have anything. The seeds we would have planted in our own vineyard, we are going to plant in your own. Yet you have never been to the vineyard once to see how it's like. All you just expect is the money. The same thing too. That's how you live too with your jobs. Your job. The way you rush and dress up, even take your bath. Some of you don't bathe well. Just to just spray perfume, wear your clothes, just to run to work. And you're on top of the police officer gives you tickets. For just a $10 job per hour, yet you have $138 tickets to pay. Because you forgot your driver's license. You were rushing to work. He says you are like that woman. Aye. Of course your boss appreciates your effort. You are very dependable. But at the end, he says, hey, this one doesn't have anything. That the one who rightfully owns her, or one who should rightfully own her, should benefit from. I think if young ladies can pay attention to what we're saying, they will minimize their excesses of going to parties.
Yeah,
you know, engaging in all those wild activities.
Yeah.
Because at the end of the day, the guy who is marrying you, it's like he's marrying a leftover. We wonder how some ladies feel when on their wedding day, three ex-boyfriends attended the wedding. And they are coming to tell her congratulations. Three ex-boyfriends. All came. They even gave you a hug. They even told you, I'm happy for you. How come none of them could marry you? We wonder what they think of the man that is marrying you now, like my brother. We have the best of her. You are just marrying. Is it them? So sometimes you begin to wonder. Okay, even the last guy that you did not marry, even the last person you were with that you did not marry, do they even appreciate you to say, of a truth, you are a good person? Some don't really care. You spent your money. You even gave me money to pay school fees. You did so much. Assisted him with rent when they needed him. And I am the way. You are not the problem. I think something is wrong with me. I'm the one with the problem. It's just me. Solomon is saying, I'm already engaged. It's not my fault. You see why? So what Solomon is trying to communicate to us, King Solomon, what he's trying to communicate to us is that there are some people who do so much yet achieve nothing. Why some? They do little and it becomes much. And the reason why some who do so much achieve nothing is because they did it for others at the detriment of themselves. What did Paul say? Go to Acts chapter. Don't close that sort of sermon. Some of you want to close it in the morning. Don't close it in the morning. Open it today. At least in the next few minutes, you look at it, then when it enters your spirit. Acts chapter 20.
Yeah.
Acts chapter 20.
Amen.
Acts chapter 20. Here, Paul called for the pastors in Miletus. In verse 17, from Miletus he sent to Ephesus and called for the pastors. The word elders there means pastors of the church. Alright, now when you read down, you get to where he said, in verses 28. Read verses 28.
Therefore, take heed.
Come on now, come on. Let's read. This, you know what we always tell you to read? There's something about vocalizing. It's spiritual. You see, it's a declaration of faith. When you read, the Bible talks about the spirit of faith. We having the same spirit of faith. According as it is written, I believe and therefore I speak. When you read, when we tell you read, you are actually speaking your belief.
Yeah.
Then it comes alive because the Bible says God listens to the conversations of those that fear him. So when we tell you read, you know what we are teaching is a conversation. And God is listening. So when we tell you read, God wants to hear your voice. That can cause him now to request for the book of remembrance to be
opened.
So we say read. It is so that, as at that point, the Lord is telling us, tell them, let them read, so that they can hear your voice and request for the book of remembrance. Malachi 3, verse 16. Because God listens to the conversations. God listens to conversations that are prayers. Some of you just read. Read verse 28 now.
Take
you to who?
Yourself.
To yourself. First. You see that? You take it to yourself what? First. Before the flow. Paul said. He said, take it to yourself first. Before the flock. In 2 Corinthians chapter 10 or chapter 11, Paul said, I have received from the Lord, verse 23, that which I also deliver. Until you receive first, you don't have anything to deliver. See that? Our Papa has told us, in this year of majesty, take care of yourself.
Yes.
It is because of what is coming.
Yes.
He said, take heed to yourselves. Who was he talking to? The pastors.
Yes. Yes.
The same way to you yourself as a member. Yeah. Take heed to yourself before your siblings. Yeah. There are many pastors the Lord has graced us to take care of. Even in Nigeria, we support, send them finances. And there was a pastor who was asking us for cash to pay his church rent. And the whole amount is about $1,000 in Naira. In Naira, that's big money. And now, he's someone who supports financially, his assistant. So I said, okay, fine. Don't worry, give me some time. I'm committed right now. Man, he will call me, call. He's a prophet too. He will call me, call. So one day, I said, the Lord just brought the thoughts to me. And I was amazed. I said, here is a pastor back in Nigeria asking me to give him $1,000 to pay for his church rent for the venue and then his own house rent and also for the school fees of his daughter. Everything amounts to like $1,000. In Naira is his big money. Yet for me, I've not even paid house rent where I even live. when he asked me for that $1,000, he began to trouble me. I said, how can we help this person? And I would pray. I discovered the Lord would just be quiet. The Lord will be quiet. The Lord will be quiet. So, one time, our Moses named Papa told us to come and see him. So we came to see Papa. And our Papa was talking to us. Then he said, listen, stop spraying your financial bullet. You can't take care of everyone. And I knew exactly what he was saying. He said, how many men of God would you help? And if he says, no, hey, I've received a letter from the court. They want to throw me out now. Hey, this and that. I said, sir, give me time. Give me time. 3 days from now, they want to throw me out. I thought they wanted to throw you out 2 days earlier. They're not, although I didn't ask him. He's a prophet. I don't know him. So,